Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on where you are. Welcome to today's conference on the care economy in Korea, beyond COVID-19 and towards a sustainable caring society, hosted by the Center for Transnational Migration and Social Inclusion, Care Work and the Economy Project, and the Population Association of Korea. My name is Joo-Hyun Lee, and it is my great honor to be emceeing this event today. This event will be conducted in a hybrid format. We'll be connecting with most of our participants online via Zoom, with a small group attending offline here in Seoul. Please note that we have made serious efforts to comply with the government's social distancing guidelines to prevent the spread of COVID-19. And we'll be asking all members participating on stage to please wear masks at all times and maintain the distance. We ask for everyone's understanding. Now, for this conference, we have brought together a truly distinguished group of speakers and participants from across the globe to engage in an in-depth discussion on the topic of care. The issue of care work has not been given due consideration in public discourse and policy agendas until very recent years. And the outbreak of COVID-19 is stalling or even reversing years of progress that has been made on multiple social inequalities. And it has exacerbated the care crisis that has further increased the already disproportionate burden shouldered by women. Now, through this conference, we hope to build our understanding on why we must place care work and the care economy at the center of post-pandemic recovery plan. And we hope that South Korea's case study will offer lessons for countries around the globe. To start off our conference, we would like to welcome a very special guest, Ms. Chung Young A, our Minister of Gender Equality and Family in South Korea, for her opening remark. Let us now meet her on video.
여러분 반갑습니다. 여성가족부 장관 정영희입니다. 코로나19와 돌봄 경제 온라인 국제 컨퍼런스 개최를 진심으로 축하드립니다. 코로나19 상황에서 우리 사회가 어떻게 하면 지속가능한 돌봄 사회로 나아갈 수 있을지를 논의하는 컨퍼런스가 개최되어 매우 뜻깊게 생각하며 이처럼 시의적절하고 귀한 자리를 마련해 주신 서울대학교 국제이주와 포용사회센터에 감사를 드립니다. 또한 30여 년 전부터 이미 Who Pays for the Kids라는 책을 비롯하여 비시장 노동, 돌봄 경제에 대한 논의를 주도해 오신 낸시 폴브레 교수님과 이번 컨퍼런스에 함께 해주신 모든 전문가분들께 감사의 말씀을 전합니다. 코로나19가 지속됨에 따라 가족, 학교, 요양시설, 보건시설 등 우리 사회 곳곳에서 돌봄이 그 어느 때보다 중요해지고 있습니다. 그러나 돌봄 노동 및 서비스는 경제적으로 여전히 저평가되고 있으며 특히 코로나19로 인해 대면 서비스 중심 돌봄 일자리의 경우에는 일자리 자체가 감소하는 상황도 심각하게 나타나고 있습니다. 또한 돌봄 분야 종사자의 다수를 차지하는 여성 노동자들의 경우 업무가 과중되거나 고용 불안정과 저임금으로 인한 생계의 위협에 직면하기도 하고 있습니다. 다른 한편 코로나19로 더욱 늘어난 돌봄 부담이 주로 여성들에게 집중되는 문제도 확대되고 있습니다. 한국의 경우 코로나19 이전에는 조금씩 증가 추세에 있던 여성 경제활동 참가율이 2020년 소폭 감소하였는데 조사 결과 전년 대비 증가한 여성 비경제활동 인구 중 72.1%가 가사와 육아로 인한 것으로 나타났습니다. 그동안 한국 정부는 코로나19 상황에서 돌봄 공백을 최소화하고 돌봄 부담이 가족에게 가중되는 문제를 완화하기 위해 지난해 말 코로나19 시대 지속가능한 돌봄 체계 개선 방안을 마련하여 돌봄 사각지대를 발굴하고 취약계층 상황에 맞는 긴급 돌봄 서비스를 제공하는 등 코로나19 상황에 맞게 돌봄 체계를 재정비해 왔습니다. 또한 아동, 노인, 장애인 등 대상별로 재가 서비스 및 비대면 돌봄 서비스 체계를 구축했으며 가족 돌봄 지원과 아동에 대한 모니터링도 강화하고 있습니다. 특히 재가 아이돌봄 서비스의 정부 지원 시간과 이용료 지원 비율을 늘렸으며 코로나19 현장에서 밤낮으로 고생하는 의료진과 방역 종사자들의 자녀 돌봄을 지원하기 위해 아이돌봄 서비스에 대한 정부 지원을 한시적으로 확대하기도 했습니다. 올해 3월에는 코로나19 여성 고용위기 회복 대책을 수립해 코로나19 상황에서 더욱 두드러지게 나타나는 노동시장의 성별격차를 해소하고자 노력하고 있습니다. 이 대책에는 사회서비스원을 전국으로 확대해 돌봄 서비스 노동자의 직접 고용을 추진하고 가사 근로자 고용 개선 등에 관한 법률 제정으로 가사 근로자의 근로 조건을 보호하는 등 돌봄 노동자의 노동 여건을 개선하기 위한 정책도 포함되어 있습니다. 여성가족부는 코로나19라는 위기 속에서 돌봄 상황의 개선을 바탕으로 여성 고용 안전망을 강화하고 노동시장 성별 격차를 완화해 나가고자 합니다. 지난 3월 세계 여성의 날을 기념하여 개최된 UN 여성지위위원회 장관급 원탁회의 등에서 코로나19 상황에서 발생하는 여러 돌봄 위기와 대응 노력이 한국뿐 아니라 전 세계에 공통적으로 이루어지고 있는 현상임을 확인할 수 있었습니다. 국경을 넘어 사회적으로 돌봄의 가치가 제대로 평가되고 성평등한 돌봄 부담이 이루어질 수 있으려면 국내적인 노력뿐 아니라 국제적인 연대와 협력이 필요합니다. 이를 위해 한국 정부는 유엔위원과 함께 금년 중에 아시아 태평양 지역을 중심으로 성평등 증진을 위한 연구개발, 교육훈련, 파트너십 구축 등을 수행할 국제기구의 국내 설립을 추진하고 있습니다. 코로나19로 인해 아시아 태평양 지역에서 여성의 돌봄 부담 등 성차별이 심화되는 문제에 대응하기 위한 플랫폼 역할을 하는 것 역시 이 기구가 수행할 중요한 역할 중 하나가 될 것입니다. 한국 정부는 앞으로 돌봄을 비롯한 여러 영역에서 성평등이 이루어질 수 있도록 국제사회와의 협력을 강화해 나갈 것입니다. 지속가능한 돌봄사회 실현을 위해 보다 거시적이고 장기적인 대응 방안을 모색하기 위한 논의의 장이 필요한 시점에서 이번 온라인 국제 컨퍼런스가 가지는 의미는 매우 큽니다. 오늘 논의되는 의제만 살펴보더라도 코로나19와 돌봄 경제, 돌봄과 국가 경제 성장에 있어서의 돌봄 경제의 역할, 돌봄 경제를 통한 지속가능한 성장 모색, 코로나19와 한국 사회의 돌봄 위기 등 하나하나가 매우 시의적절하고 중요한 이슈들입니다. 대한민국을 비롯한 세계 각국의 학계, 국제기구, 시민단체 등에서 오신 전문가분들께서 이에 대해 각자의 이론과 경험을 토대로 의미 있고 발전적인 논의를 해주실 것이라 믿습니다. 다시 한번 코로나19와 돌봄 경제 온라인 국제 컨퍼런스 개최를 축하드리며 오늘 컨퍼런스를 통해 지속가능한 돌봄 사회를 만들기 위한 구체적인 논의가 이루어지기 바랍니다. 또 논의 결과가 사회적 담론으로 확산되는 동시에 정부 정책에도 유의미하게 반영될 수 있기를 기대합니다. 여성가족부에서도 적극 동참하겠습니다. 감사합니다.
Thank you, Minister Chung Young-ae, for highlighting the significance of our conference. And it is great to know that the Ministry of Gender and Equality is with us to support the cause and to address the issues of care. Next, we have another very special guest, Mr. Mark Malloch-Brown, President of Open Society Foundations, to provide welcome remarks. Let us also meet him on video.
Greetings to Minister Jung Young-ae and to the many colleagues and collaborators in the room today. And I'm sorry I cannot join you in person because of the pandemic. It's a great pleasure to particularly greet our Open Society grantee partners in Seoul. Seoul's National University Center for Transnational Migration and Social Inclusion, and the Care Work and Economy Research Consortium, hosted by the Economic Department of American University in Washington, D.C. I especially want to thank Professor Un Ki Su from SNU's Graduate School of International Studies. The critical research you're all undertaking to develop macroeconomic models for South Korea that integrate care work present a really significant opportunity for a thoughtful restructuring of the South Korean economy. For example, the high cost of childcare and the lack of paid leave are holding so many working parents back, especially women, and particularly now during the COVID-19 pandemic. Many are even leaving their jobs. A childcare subsidy could increase women's participation in the workforce and help boost the economy in the long run. So any future growth must be grounded in the human rights of all people. Those rights and economic growth are intimately linked when people are included and enabled to join the workplace. They contribute to their society and economy while also being much happier participating citizens in their society. And so it's a real honour to support your work. We at the Open Society Foundations believe profoundly, not just in political justice, but economic justice. And we recognise that gender inequality crosses both those fields in the fight for open societies around the world. And we at Open Society also believe that everybody should have a voice in the policies that affect them. And that this is certainly true for the women and care workers who are the backbone of so much of the global economy. And you know, my colleagues reminded me of, in preparing for this, of all the extraordinary stories of, you know, women leaving the kitchen at dramatic moments during the history of the last century to stand up for their rights around recognition of what they do in the home. 50 years ago almost, in 1975, 90% of Icelandic women abandoned their paid jobs, childcare and elder care duties for a day of street demonstrations. The goal? To highlight the importance of all women's work and care work, formal and informal, paid and unpaid in the country. They demanded equal wages, more women in leadership and support for mothers and care workers in their country. And, you know, while we still don't really have a very good grasp on the global data, we know that across the world, every day, women spend more time in unpaid and domestic work. An average is given of 4.1 hours per day, compared to under half that for men. Women's unpaid contribution to healthcare equates to some almost 2.5% of global GDP. And, you know, when during this pandemic we saw offices and factories and banks and schools closed, men were left scrambling how to cover childcare. Many people called in sick. Others brought their kids to work, a challenge familiar to any parent in the room. And, you know, I think it is clear that as we look forward at gender roles, what began in Iceland, or at least was highlighted in Iceland, has struck the world. The same demonstrations that brought Icelandic men's version of life to a halt has done the same through the health disaster of COVID. We need a fairer society which recognises and rewards the role of women more completely. And, you know, today as world leaders are addressing how we rebound from the pandemic, how we build in longer term resilience to our economies, we have an immense opportunity to build back forward better through sustained investments in gender responsive social protections and integration systems, ensure that they are affordable and accessible. Governments around the world must prioritise the creation of integrated care systems that cover care needs across the life course and rely less on unpaid work and more on collective and community and solidarity-based solutions. Now, this social infrastructure is critical in any country to build a healthy and sustainable economy. It's frankly just as essential to the functioning of the economy as roads and bridges are. I argued in the opening that, you know, paid family leave and policies of that kind improve child and parental health. They facilitate when they're accompanied by high quality childcare facilities, children's development, and high quality care for older members of families, for the elderly, allows all people to live with dignity. South Korea, which was such a leader in the early response to this pandemic, which deployed disciplined tools of public policy and social mobilization to contain and defeat the virus in those early weeks and months, you know, can so obviously bring those same skills to bear to broaden the social contract at home. The growth and development of South Korea has been one of the sort of economic success stories and miracles of the last 75 years. And now we call on it again to be a leader in building this more gender inclusive economy as we go forward. And we're very excited to see in a forum like this conference the challenge to South Korean government to adopt models of this kind. Because a foundation like ours can support and prompt through our grants to academic and policy-making partners. But the resources needed for this transformational shift in direction of a national economy and ultimately the global economy needs the leadership and resources of governments. We can pilot, we can encourage, we can advocate, but it is in the hands of the people of South Korea and their government to make these changes, to welcome women into an even fuller engagement in all aspects of life and to help determine the country's future. So as we look at this for us very successful investment and grant making to bring this issue to prominence through our South Korean partners, we turn the baton and the challenge and the torch back to the minister and the government and the people of South Korea to make sure that they enable this great leap forward in terms of a more inclusive economy and to see it in its historical, if you like, arc of how, you know, women have come into the workplace as the workplace itself has changed, as the structure of work has changed, the structure of the continuous career revolving through education, jobs, relearning, further jobs, as all these trends roil the traditional economy of 100 years ago, where the man went to work and the woman stayed at home. You know, as we go through those transformations, in the same way that South Korea has challenged us all with the economic success story, the way Korean families were willing to defer advancement today in terms of ensuring the education of their children and the next generation, and through that investment in education have created a world-leading competitive economy. We ask again for the same multi-generational vision, the same commitment to inclusion that was made to education in the past. So the challenge is to you, Minister, and to all your colleagues. Let South Korea lead again on this agenda as it has on others in the past. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Malloch-Brown, for the leadership that you have presented and for your words that call upon the governments and the people around the world to make the commitment to proceed to making an important social transformation at this critical era. All right, to start off our conference, I would like to welcome a very special guest for today. We have Mr. Jeongwoo, the CEO of POSCO, to provide opening remarks. Let us meet him on video.
2021 국제 돌봄 정책 컨퍼런스 개최를 진심으로 축하드립니다. POSCO 회장 최정호입니다. 코로나19와 돌봄 경제, 지속 가능한 돌봄 사회의 전환을 테마로 열리는 이번 국제 컨퍼런스는 글로벌 사회가 안고 있는 돌봄의 필요성과 대책 강구의 시급성을 널리 알리고 사회 전반의 동참을 유도하는 매우 의미 있는 자리로 생각됩니다. 유엔이 발표한 세계 인구 동향 전망에 따르면 전 세계 합계 출산율은 1990년 3.2명에서 2020년 2.5명으로 급격히 감소하였습니다. 여성의 사회 진출이 확대되고 성평등이 유엔의 17개 지속가능 발전 목표에 포함되어 있지만 가사와 자녀에 대한 돌봄 노동은 여전히 여성에게 집중되어 저출산을 심화시키는 요인으로 작용하고 있습니다. 반면 전 세계 65세 이상 고령자 수는 2020년 7억 명에서 2050년 15억 명으로 증가할 것으로 전망되고 있습니다. 특히 거동이 불편하거나 만성질환을 겪고 있는 고령자 수가 늘어남에 따라 고령인구에 대한 돌봄 역시 심각한 사회문제로 부각되고 있습니다. UN과 국제노동기구에서도 이러한 육아 부담에 대한 여성의 경력 단절과 고령화로 인한 돌봄 수요 증가에 대응하여 돌봄 경제 확대의 필요성을 강조하고 있습니다. 돌봄은 사회 구성원들이 안심하고 생활할 수 있도록 해주는 물, 공기와 같은 것입니다. 한번 파괴되면 복구하기 어려운 환경처럼 돌봄 결손이 심각해지면 대책 마련은 더욱 어렵습니다. 한국 사회도 고령화와 저출산 문제를 함께 겪고 있지만 한국의 합계 출산율이 2019년 0.92명에서 2020년 0.84명까지 하락하는 등 세계 최저 수준을 기록한 것만 보아도 저출산 문제가 더욱 심각한 상황입니다. 그간 한국 사회는 정부의 주도로 저출산 문제를 해결하기 위해 노력해왔지만 이제는 기업을 포함한 사회 공동체 구성원 모두가 함께 해법을 찾아야 할 시점입니다. 저출산으로 인구가 감소하면 생산 가능 인구가 줄고 그로 인한 소비와 시장의 위축은 기업의 지속 가능성을 제외하는 요인으로 작용할 수밖에 없습니다. 이는 포스코가 저출산에 관심을 갖고 있는 이유이기도 합니다. 포스코는 2018년 더불어 함께 발전하는 기업 시민을 경영 이념으로 선포하고 탄소 중립, 동반 성장, 벤처 육성 등과 함께 출산 친화를 기업 시민 5대 브랜드로 설정하여 기업 차원의 롤모델 제시를 위해 노력하고 있습니다. 직원들의 결혼, 임신, 출산, 육아 등 라이프사이클에 맞추어 다양한 제도를 운영 중에 있으며 이 자리에 참석하신 여러분들께 참고가 될 만한 대표적인 사례를 몇 가지 소개해드리고자 합니다. 먼저 직원들의 출산 장려 및 육아기 경력 단절 방지를 위해 작년 7월에 국내 기업 최초로 도입한 육아기 재택근무 제도입니다. 이 제도는 경력관리에서 중요한 시기에 있는 직원들이 휴직을 하지 않고도 재택근무를 통해 육아와 업무를 병행할 수 있도록 한 제도입니다. 그리고 협력사와 공급사의 직원 자녀들도 양질의 돌봄시설을 함께 이용토록 작년에 상생형 공동직장 어린이집을 건립하여 중소기업과 지역사회의 돌봄 공백 완화에도 기여하고 있습니다. 또한 저출산 이슈에 대한 사회적 공감대 형성을 위해 한국인구학회, 저출산고령사회위원회와 함께 2020 저출산 심포지엄도 개최하여 민간 학이 함께하는 저출산에 대한 사회적 논의 확산의 장을 마련하였습니다. 특히 금년에는 국제이주와 포용사회센터 그리고 한국인구학회와 함께 한국이주 여성들에게 육아 돌봄이와 같은 일자리를 제공하고 안정적으로 일할 수 있는 법적 지위 보장과 교육 프로그램 마련을 검토하는 등 출산 친화 정책화를 위한 공동 과제를 기획하고 있습니다. 아무리 정책과 제도가 훌륭하더라도 직접적인 이해 관계자인 기업의 참여가 수반되지 않으면 돌봄과 저출산 고령화의 위기는 극복하기 어렵습니다. 포스코는 다른 기업들의 동참을 유도하여 컬렉티브 임팩트를 창출하는 노력을 지속적으로 전개할 계획입니다. 오늘 이 자리에 모이신 국내외 전문가들이 제시해 주실 통찰력과 해법이 저희의 노력에 큰 보탬이 되어줄 것으로 기대합니다. 다시 한번 2021 국제 돌봄정책 컨퍼런스 개최를 진심으로 축하드리며 이러한 의미 있는 행사를 마련해 주신 서울대학교 국제학연구소 국제이주와 포용사회센터, 한국인구학회 및 아메리칸 대학교 오픈소사이어티 파운데이션에도 깊은 감사의 말씀을 드립니다. 감사합니다.
Thank you, Mr. Jeongwoo Choi, for highlighting the importance of addressing the issue of care at this critical point. We will now have another very special opening address from Professor Maria Floro, Professor of Economics at the American University, also the co-principal investigator of the Care Work and the Economy Project. Let us meet her on video.
Thank you, Ms. Lee. First of all, it's my pleasure to join a group of distinguished presenters in the second day of the conference. But first, I want to thank our organizer of this conference, the Center for Transnational Migration and Social Inclusion, based at Seoul National University, and the co-host, the Population Association of Korea, and also the conference funders and sponsors. I also want to thank the Seoul attendees of the conference, as well as those who are attending this conference virtually, some of whom are staying up late in the evening or very early in the morning to be with us. It is an honor and privilege to welcome you to the second day of the Care Economy in Korea International Conference. The theme of envisioning gender equality in a sustainable caring society for the post-pandemic future cannot be more salient and urgent. I would like to take this opportunity to introduce you to the co-host of this conference, the Care Work and the Economy Project, which started in 2017 to produce new innovative research that explicitly incorporates the care economy and gender in policy tools. This is to demonstrate the importance of understanding the economic and social implications of care work, promote gender-aware and adequate investment in care provisioning, and ultimately reduce gender gaps in economic outcomes, advance gender equality, and promote sustainable development. The overarching vision and goals of the project are strikingly relevant during the COVID-19 pandemic, which demonstrated worldwide the importance of caring for the children, elderly, the sick, in sustaining and maintaining societies and the economy. The research in this project challenges the undervaluation of care work and the invisibility of care in policy making, particularly in macroeconomic policies. This neglect of care in macroeconomic policy analysis has compromised efforts to address care needs in a comprehensive manner. As a result, we have an emerging care crisis manifested in the form of uncared elderly, disabled, the sick, and children in societies around the world. This crisis has also taken the form of silent protest against long unpaid work hours performed by women, leading to a decline in marriage rates and fertility rates that have plunged some countries, including South Korea and other parts of East Asia, into slower growth, even economic recession, and grave demographic concerns. I am heartened to know that the South Korean government's key development goals include the promotion of gender equality and women's empowerment by increasing their labor force participation. Although it has increased its support and expanded its investment in childcare and early childhood education and long-term care for the elderly, it is clear that more needs to be done. The Care Work and Economy Project selected South Korea as its pilot country study for developing gender-sensitive policy tools, such as those presented yesterday, and for deepening our understanding of care performed under different care arrangements. As our previous speaker has pointed out, Korea faces several challenges brought about by demographic shifts and economic change. Although the country experienced rapid economic growth and significant progress in other aspects of human development, the increase in life expectancy, one of the highest in the world, and a low fertility rate, the lowest in the world, have given rise to heavy care burdens. As many of the speakers in yesterday's sessions have pointed out, this meant that household members, particularly women, face increasing care demands that they are struggling to meet. The unraveling of both serious short-term and longer-term economic and welfare consequences have alarmed policymakers and society at large. In early January this year, the international media reported that South Korea's 2020 census data recorded more deaths than births for the first time ever. It's the first time that Korea has hit what is called the population death cross, when the number of deaths surpassed births, and the first time the total population has shrunk. Now, some analysts attribute this demographic fallout with access to contraceptives and anti-population growth policies of the 60s and 70s. They also attributed it to rapid economic growth, rising costs of raising children, and the notion that women would rather pursue a higher standard of living rather than raising children. But a growing body of research reveals that there are other underlying factors, including a demanding work culture that makes it difficult to balance careers with family life. And there is also the persistent unequal division of care work within families, so that the stress and tensions of long hours of unpaid caregiving continually confront women. One important activity undertaken by our Korean scholars in our project in 2018 was to conduct fieldwork and data collection through surveys and in-depth quality interviews to better understand the nature of care provisioning. These endeavors have yielded tremendously useful information and unique data not collected in standard household and labor force surveys. Some of our scholars will share their findings and valuable insights with you in the coming sessions. The advocacy groups, care worker centers, and associations also played an important role in our project undertaking, enabling us to better understand the nature of caregiving from their perspective and its impact not only in the well-being of the persons being cared for, but also that of the care workers. From the early stages of this project, we consulted, met, and engaged with stakeholders, including policymakers, research institutions, academics, as well as care workers and advocacy groups. And we tried to continue these engagements throughout the project life. This enabled us to be aware of the existing knowledge gaps, as well as key policy questions and debates around care. They also helped us sharpen the focus of our work. What the Care Work and the Economy Project scholars collectively show is that care work carries social, political, and economic significance. In many ways, the year 2020 is considered a harbinger of things to come that societies and governments will have to reckon with. Aging population, growing uncertainty, climate change, food insecurity, and inequality. We are witnessing the evolving crisis of what is called social reproduction, or the sustenance of life, and the maintenance and enhancement of capabilities of people as workers and members of society. This global pandemic exposes the heavy demand on those who carry responsibility for providing care, the vast majority of whom are women. Continued neglect or undermining the performance of caring activities may irreversibly reduce the capacity of societies of having healthy, productive, and capable persons and meeting the needs of future generations. We also have seen that economic growth and the expansion of the care market are not necessarily adequate panacea. They can be reversed, they can be inequality intensifying, and they can produce both high and low quality of care. Moreover, the gains from economic growth and the economic welfare costs of economic recessions can be unevenly distributed across sectors, households, and between women and men. Widening income disparities have also created diverse types of care arrangements and have shifted distribution of caregivers across social classes and even national boundaries. The quality and adequacy of care received by people within the same country can be very different, which help perpetuate and even exacerbate the imbalances in the process of social reproduction. Income inequality can generate a solution in many societies for the growing demand for care to those who have the private means to hire nannies, domestic help, paid care workers on a full-time basis, or use daycare centers and nursing homes where care workers tend to be lowly paid. Throughout the world, for the working poor and low-income households, hiring domestic help or a paid caregiver is simply unaffordable. And these households are often compelled to rely on their own labor, sometimes on their relatives and kinship networks for assistance. In some countries, it is typically girls who are removed from school in order to care for younger children and accomplish domestic tasks, thus contributing to household survival at the expense of long-term education and employment opportunities. Or they are sent to the cities to work as domestic helpers or care workers. Many women migrate from rural to urban areas or from their own countries to other countries as migrant care workers to provide paid care for the elderly and the young, but often with very limited rights, no access to social protection, and subject to discrimination. As one study points out, care arrangements within the same country, even cities, can turn out to be worlds apart, while care itself becomes one of the drivers of growing inequality. Care of people, as with the care of environment, encompass intergenerational issues concerning relationships and commitments between the current generation and future generations. Our short-term horizon objective of meeting our needs today must be accompanied by a longer-term horizon, one involving the needs of the passing generations. I'm referring to the frail elderly retired workers today, and those of future generations. The latter requires a much more visceral perception of the multi-level interdependence of people and generations, and the moral responsibility it requires is profound. We need a new transformative vision of a gender-equal caring economy and society, one that provides a deep understanding of the fundamental need for care of our ecosystem and people, and one that demands our policies acknowledge and support this task and actions. In addressing the evolving care crisis, such a vision requires reframing development questions or inquiry in terms of provisioning for human life and involves developing a policy agenda for reallocation of resources and for promoting a shared responsibility of families and communities, the private sector, and government in the provisioning of quality care for all, as well as the equal sharing of responsibilities between men and women. Ultimately, the solutions that will address the crisis of care and that of ecological sustainability demand from academics, policymakers, and the rest of society a recognition of common humanity and substantive responsibilities for care that has more to do with commitment and political will, as well as collective action of communities, businesses, governments, and households. Thank you.